Okay, together corporately. If you have your bulletins, I'll be on the back side of it. We've got some announcements. We'll just make some brief announcements here. Today we have the fellowship meal with Q&A prayer emphasis today. Tuesday, ladies' prayer and share at 7 p.m. Friday, men and boys' prayer in the morning. And then next Sunday, homemade soup and bread, fellowship meal, hymn sing. We still have several slots that need to be filled in, so if you would like to do that, that would be great. We also have mowing and flower beds sign up as well. We could use some more people for that as well, too. For the birthdays, Amos Rogers is today. Caitlin Bragg and Emmett DeValle is Monday. Thomas Glenn is Saturday. And for anniversaries, we have Ben and Nikki Monday. And then Patrick and Kim Kelly Thursday. So happy birthday and happy anniversary, respectively. On the inside of your bulletin, you will see the scripture called the worship, meditation scripture, however you like to see it. It's found in John 1:11 through 13. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of natural descent, or of the will of flesh, or of the will of man, but of God.
Good morning. Open your hymnals to hymn number 449 or in your bulletins. To God be the glory. Please stand.
To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. O perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God, the offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus. us the Son, but purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Now turn over in your bulletin or hymnal to hymn number 42. All hail the power of Jesus.
Psalm 146 to guide our thoughts this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord while I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Do not trust in princes, in mortal man in whom there is no salvation. His spirit departs, he returns to the earth. In that very day his thoughts perish. How blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made the heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord raises up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord protects the strangers. He supports the fatherless and the widow, but he thwarts the way of the wicked. The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, praise the Lord. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we echo the psalmist, praise the Lord. We have not put our trust in human beings, human leaders, mere mortals, because in them there is no salvation. But we have put our trust in you, the Lord our God, the creator of heaven and earth. You alone are forever faithful, and one day you will bring perfect justice throughout the earth. And in the meantime, you provide for all the needs of your people. We praise you that you have filled the hungry, liberated captives, given sight to the blind, raised up those who are bowed down, and comforted those who are oppressed. Indeed, how blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God. We praise you that you love perfectly and everlastingly those who are covered with your righteousness. We worship you, Lord, as the maker and the sustainer of all things. We give you thanks, O God. We glorify you for your wondrous deeds. And as blessed as we are to be under the cover of your grace, however, we do confess that we have sinned. We have broken your law, which is written in our hearts as well as in the scriptures. We have disregarded the voice of conscience and spurned the clear direction of your spirit. Worse yet, we have at times refused the clear commands of your holy word. And yet you daily show us grace, long-suffering, and patience, and in Christ we are forgiven. We praise you for that. We ask that you would continue to purge our lives of sin, to cleanse our souls from guilt, to deliver us from sinful and earthly affections, to guide our feet away from the path of evil, and to make us walk in the way of righteousness for the sake of your holy name. That we would pursue the beauty of your holiness and the security of the hope that you have set before us. Well, Lord, we ask that we would never lose our firm assurance in a salvation that is forever. We praise you and thank you for equipping us with suitable spiritual armor to protect us against the wiles of the evil one. Thank you for such a great high priest, our Lord Jesus, who always intercedes for us. Thank you for your word, which guides us and teaches us. And we ask today that it would graciously empower us, that we might bind it upon our hearts and set our minds upon you. Oh, how we long to understand your truths, to observe how you operate, so that we can see blessing in every trial and joy in every sorrow. Lord, fill our hearts this morning with gratitude and praise. May we see your good design in everything. Cause us, Lord, to proclaim your gospel to those who will hear. And may we gain a better hearing because both our doctrine and our life manifest the glory of Christ in his saving work. And Lord, in every condition of life, whether we struggle or prosper, whether we suffer or rejoice, help us to know that in your hands all these things are being worked together for our good and for your eternal glory. Father, we are privileged to be called your children, and we pour out our hearts in prayer to you, our loving Father. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
Around, can you believe that everything you see? took place by chance. The intricate design, down to the last detail. And what about the mystery that cuts us like a knife? What is the source of life? Oh, His love is written all across the sky, as brilliantly the stars all testify. For the glory of the God who reigns on high is displayed in the world He has made. And as all creation seems to shout and sing in wonder of the one Almighty King, His signature can easily be seen on everything. Oh, His love is written all across the sky, as brilliantly the stars all testify. For the glory of the God who reigns on high is displayed in the world He has made. And this whole creation seems to shout and sing in wonder of the one Almighty King. His signature can easily be seen on
everything. In your bulletins now, we're going to sing Here Is Love. Stand with me as we sing.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the prince of life, our ransom, shed for us His precious blood, who His love will not remember, who can cease to sing His praise? He can never be forgotten throughout the mount of crucifixion, mountains open deep and wide, through the floodgates of God's mercy flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love, like mighty rivers, poured incessant from above. Heaven's peace and perfect justice kissed and guilty world in love. Here is love that conquered evil, Christ the firstborn from the grave. Death has failed to be found equal to the life of Him who saves. In the valley of our darkness dawned His everlasting light. Perfect love in glorious radiance has repelled the fear. That same love beyond a measure, mocked and slain by hateful men, that's ingrained in resurrection and can never
Isaiah 11. I'm going to read the whole chapter. Excuse me. Isaiah 11. Then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and strength, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord, and he will not judge by what his eyes see, nor make a decision by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he will judge the poor, and decide with fairness for the afflicted of the earth. And he will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Also righteousness will be the belt about his loins, and faithfulness the belt about his waist. And the wolf will dwell with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little boy will lead them. Also the cow and the bear will graze, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. And the nursing child will play by the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child will put his hand on the viper's den. They will not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Then it will come about in that day that the nations will resort to the root of Jesse, who will stand as a signal for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious. Then it will happen on that day that the Lord will again recover the second time with his hand the remnant of his people who will remain from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, Elam, Shinar, Hamath, and from the islands of the sea. And he will lift up a standard for the nations, and will assemble the banished ones of Israel, and will gather the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Then the jealousy of Ephraim will depart, and those who harass Judah will be cut off. Ephraim will not be jealous of Judah, and Judah will not harass Ephraim. And they will swoop down on the slopes of the Philistines on the west. Together they will plunder the sons of the east. They will possess Edom and Moab, and the sons of Ammon will be subject to them. And the Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of the sea of Egypt, and he will wave his hand over the river with his scorching wind, and he will strike it into seven streams and make men walk over dry shod. And there will be a highway from Assyria for the remnant of his people who will be left, just as there was for Israel in the day that they came up out of Egypt, out of the land of Egypt. Let's pray. Dear Dearly Father, Lord, I thank you for your word. And as we see in this text, some partially fulfilled things in Christ and some things yet to come. And Lord, we're thankful that you brought us your Son, our righteous judge, who judges us not by what he sees or hears, but with righteousness and fairness. For you are righteous and you are fair. There is nothing else in you. You are good to us. And Lord, I thank you that we can trust you, that you will bring about your word, that there will be a time when conflict will cease and we will live in peace under your reign. We look forward to that day. And we're thankful that even now we can at least live in peace within our hearts because of what you've done for us on the cross. You've reconciled us to yourself, and we're oh so thankful, Lord. We praise you for that. I pray, Lord, that you would work in our hearts and our minds today in this service, challenge us in our lives, that we would live lives worthy of the gospel, that we would live lives that are honoring to you, and, Lord, that we would draw nearer to you in our hearts and our minds. And, Lord, if there's any that don't know you, Lord, that even today they may come to faith in you and experience the joy of freedom in you. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to do a new song now, Immanuel. Stand with me. It's in your bulletin. Hopefully some of you had a chance to listen to it. From the squalor of a borrowed stable, by the Spirit and a virgin's faith, to the anguish and the shame of scandal, came the Savior of the human race. But the skies were filled with the praise of heaven, shepherds listen as the angels tell of the gift of God come down to man at the dawning of Immanuel. From the King been now a friend of sinners, humble servant in the Father's hands, filled with power and the Holy Spirit, filled with mercy for the broken man. Yes, he walked my road, and he felt my pain, joys and sorrows that I know so well. Yet his righteous steps give me hope again. I will follow my Immanuel. Through the kisses of a friend's betrayal, he was lifted on a cruel cross. He was punished for a world's transgressions. He was suffering to save the lost. He fights for breath. He fights for me, loosing sinners from the claims of hell. And with a shout, our souls are free, death defeated by Immanuel. Now he's standing at the place of honor, crowned with glory on the highest throne, interceding for his own beloved.
father calls to bring them home. Then the skies will part as the trumpet sounds. Hope of heaven or the fear of hell, but the bride will run to her lover's arms, giving glory to Immanuel. Then the skies will part as the trumpet sounds. Hope of heaven or the fear of hell, but the bride will run to her lover's arms, giving glory to Immanuel.
Thank you. May we see.
Good morning, church. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 1. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 17 this morning. If you're a guest with us today, this is the part of our service where we open God's Word, read it, explain it, and then think about how to apply it in our lives. I'll be reading from the Christian Standard Bible this morning. Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 17. Hear the word of the Lord. An account of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham fathered Isaac, Isaac fathered Jacob, Jacob fathered Judah and his brothers, Judah fathered Perez and Zerah by Tamar, Perez fathered Hezron, Hezron fathered Aram, Aram fathered Amminadab, Amminadab fathered Nashon, Nashon fathered Salmon, Salmon fathered Boaz by Rahab, Boaz fathered Obed by Ruth, Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered King David. David fathered Solomon by Uriah's wife, Solomon fathered Rehoboam, Rehoboam fathered Abijah, Abijah fathered Asa, Asa fathered Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat fathered Joram, Joram fathered Uzziah, Uzziah fathered Jotham, Jotham fathered Ahaz, Ahaz fathered Hezekiah, Hezekiah fathered Manasseh, Manasseh fathered Ammon, Ammon fathered Josiah, and Josiah fathered Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. After the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah fathered Shealtiel, Shealtiel fathered Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel fathered Abiud, Abiud fathered Eliakim, Eliakim fathered Azor, Azor fathered Zadok, Zadok fathered Akim, Akim fathered Eliud, Eliud fathered Eleazar, Eleazar fathered Mathan, Mathan fathered Jacob, and Jacob fathered Joseph, the husband of Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, who was called the Messiah. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David until the exile to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the exile to Babylon until the Messiah, 14 generations. Let's pray together. Our Father, we ask that you would bless our attendance upon your word this day. Show it to us as your inspired word meant for our edification, and enable us to see the wonderful things which you have stored up for us in your word. And we will give you all the praise and all the glory, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever witnessed to someone and said, you really ought to read the New Testament? And they proceed to read the New Testament, but they start in Matthew, and they read this passage, and they get back to you and say, I thought this was the book of life, but this book is boring. This stuff about this person is the father of whom just doesn't interest me. How do we explain a genealogy at the beginning of the New Testament? Well, if you're going to write about a king or about a ruler, say a book about Charles or a biography about Elizabeth, that might come out. Somewhere early on, there's going to be a chart, there's going to be a graph, there's going to be a family tree. You had better demonstrate the direct line that provides them the right to rule. And that's what Matthew does. Matthew opens with a genealogy as though you are looking at a family tree that emerges out of the dry, dead stump of Adam's race. And flowering forth from this stump comes one by way of a promise that emerges into these three symmetrical, beautifully illustrated parts of the tree that leads you to Jesus. And so the placement, I think, is strategic. If Matthew's right in what he's going to argue in the book, that Jesus is the rightful king, then a genealogy would be the right way to begin. But does this message have a message for us today? I'm going to try to argue today that you and I would do well to let Jesus run our lives because he's the rightful king who fulfills God's gracious promises. Matthew's opening genealogy announces the arrival in world history of Jesus Christ. This was a long-anticipated moment in an ongoing story. Matthew shows us that Jesus came as the climax of the Old Testament storyline. He is the long-awaited Messiah, the King who will bring to fulfillment all of God's gracious promises to rescue his people and restore this broken world. And so that's the main point I want us to see and believe today. And I want us to consider three aspects of this genealogy this morning. First, we see from the pattern of the genealogy that Jesus came from a true historical family. Second, we see from the purpose of the genealogy that Jesus came from a royal family. And third, we see from the people in the genealogy that Jesus came from a broken family. So let's consider together Jesus' royally broken family. First, consider the pattern of Jesus' genealogy. And I want us to make here three observations about this true family history. And the first observation would be that this family history is salvation history. We read in verse 1, an account of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. From his titles to his genealogy, Matthew clearly situates Jesus within the history of the Old in general and in the Old Testament story in particular. How so? Well, the this is the genealogy formula marks the book of Genesis, doesn't it? That's the beginning of the story. And then we see there throughout, this is the generations of this person, this is the generations of the people of Adam, this is the generations of Abraham, and so on. And in the Greek here, in the New Testament, begins, this is the genesis, literally, of Jesus Christ. So he's making a connection. This is a new beginning, a new creation when the Messiah comes on the scene. And then Matthew moves from his book title to Jesus' titles. We notice there he calls him Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. He's giving us a concise and yet a thick description of Jesus' identity. The Abrahamic element highlights Jesus as the hope of the nations, and the Davidic element highlights Jesus as the fulfillment of the promised Messiah. And so he's the fulfillment of all of salvation history. And so we need to read this family history as part of a continuing story. Like a book with chapters, the Old Testament is a singular, epic story that progresses from one shorter story to the next. The story begins with the creation of the world, plunges into the fall into sin, and then rises with God's promise to make all things right again. And according to the contours of Matthew's genealogy, the outworking of this promise begins with Abraham, and then progresses through kingship with David, and then exile into Babylon. And then it ends with an increased longing for the arrival of the Christ or the Messiah. And so this opening to Matthew's gospel is more than a list of names. It's a genealogical story wherein the history of Israel is reviewed and brought to its proper climax in Jesus Christ. The Jews who knew the Old Testament would see immediately from this genealogy, Jesus is the promised one. Jesus is the one the prophets foretold. You know, maybe you didn't feel this way, as we just read through those list of names, but they would feel a thrill, right? They knew the promises of the Messiah. They knew the Messiah was promised to bring salvation and deliverance. And because the story of the genealogy, the story of Jesus, is their story too, right? It's not just the story of some alien family. It's the story of their family, their history, and their future. In the modern world today, right, we think of ourselves as individuals first. Do you know what your great-grandparents did for a living? Do you even know their names? But for most of history, people thought of themselves as something else first. Who you are is who your parents are and who your grandparents are. And one of the interesting features of this genealogy is it doesn't tell us a story of all of human history. Right? It doesn't even go back all the way to Adam. If you compare the genealogy in Luke, that one goes all the way back to Adam. But this genealogy goes back to Abraham, the father of the Jewish people, the father of the people of the promise. And so this is a genealogy that focuses on salvation, on the fulfillment of God's promises. And what does that mean to us? The most important thing in the world is to belong to this family, this genealogy. Now, how do you get to be part of this family as it continues on? How do you get to be a son of Jesus? Well, you get to be a child of Abraham, and Jesus is the seed of Abraham. You get to be part of this family by faith. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 3, "For through faith you are all sons of God in Christ Jesus. For those of you who are baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ. There is no Jew or Greek, slave or free, male and female, since you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed, heirs according to the promise." Right? All those who trust in Jesus, all those who belong to Jesus, are part of Abraham's family now. And so we get tied into this family, not biologically, but spiritually. And isn't that a remarkable thing? We get tied into a family that we're not from originally. We get grafted in. We get adopted into this family. And this family is the most important family in the world to be part of. This family, the family of Jesus, the family of Abraham. It's more important than our nuclear families. Right? Our nuclear families are important, aren't they? But most important is this family. Some Christians give their devotion to their nuclear family over their family of the family of God. Now, it takes wisdom, right? We have responsibilities as moms, dads, children. I'm not denying that. But sometimes it might trump our responsibility to the family of God, what God has called us to be as his people. Remember what Jesus said, "He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me." Right? Jesus comes first, and his family takes priority even over our lives. Now, the second observation, this family history is structured history. Matthew very carefully structured this genealogy and arranged it so that it consists of three groups of 14 generations. Look at verse 17. So we're looking at the bookend of this genealogy. "So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David until the exile to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the exile to Babylon until the Messiah, 14 generations. So just notice here the key points in Israel's history. Abraham to David, David to the exile in Babylon, and from the exile to the birth of Christ. And we'll learn as we proceed, we'll come back to the importance of Abraham and the David and the exile and the birth. But here, I just want you to notice, this is carefully structured, right? This is carefully arranged. Why do we have three groups of 14? One answer is because it would be easier to memorize. Remember, people in the ancient world were much better at memorizing than we are. They didn't rely so much on books and media as we do. And so 42 names, that's daunting for me. It's probably daunting for you. I've never memorized this. Even trying to imagine memorizing this is difficult. But this is something they could do. But I think there's a deeper reason for the groups of 14, and the reason goes back to an ancient practice called gematria. This was a system that the Hebrews used to apply numbers to Hebrew letters. If we were to do this with our alphabet, right, A would be 1, B would be worth 2, C would be worth 3, and so on. Well, when you add up the value of David's name in Hebrew, DVD, 4 plus 6 plus 4, you get 14. David's name in Hebrew is equivalent to the number 14. His name is also the 14th name in Matthew's list. So Matthew is going out of his way to connect King David to King Jesus. His point is that Jesus is the rightful heir to the throne of David because he's a direct descendant of David. Jesus is the king because he has the right family history. Now here's a question we need to ask. Did Matthew make a mistake with his structure? Are there errors in this genealogy? We're talking here about history. Does Matthew's genealogy contradict Luke's genealogy? You may not have read Luke's genealogy, but that's in Luke chapter 3, and you can read it later. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but I want to say something about this from the pulpit, because sometimes people say, I went to church all my life, and apparently all the preachers and the Sunday school teachers didn't know about problems that are in the Bible. They never answered any questions that I had. So, I want to say that the Bible is rooted in historical truth. We can trust it, because history matters. Truth matters. God doesn't just speak to our hearts. We're not here today just so that we feel good emotionally. God doesn't just speak to our hearts, he also speaks to our heads. And God is interested in truth. He's interested in historical reliability. We believe in Christianity because it's true, right? Not fundamentally because it makes us feel better. We believe it because it's the truth. It's the way things really are. So let's think about this for a little bit. Some people have actually pointed out that when you count the numbers of the generations, it seems to be wrong. The numbers seem to be 13, 14, and 13. But Matthew says there's three generations of 14. Wait a minute. Did he count it wrong? Did he make a mistake? Well, I would say no. He didn't count wrong. I believe he counted David twice and Jeconiah twice because they're so important. David, because he's the king, and Jeconiah, because of the time when they went to exile. I don't think there's a mistake here. Matthew knew how to count to 14, okay? He wasn't that dumb. He structured it carefully and intentionally. Let's point out something else here. You may not have noticed this, but if you actually read this again, Matthew actually skips some of the kings. He doesn't name every one of them. Did he not know what he was doing there? Well, again, certainly not. Matthew knows the Old Testament very well. If you read the Old Testament genealogy, it's common even there to skip over some of the generations. That's not an unusual feature. Right? The word father of could also mean ancestor of, and it would allow for this type of thing. And so we don't have, you know, a literalistic strict counting of the generations here as if none are skipped. That's not a surprising thing to do that. One more thing. Does Matthew's genealogy contradict Luke's? Matthew traces Jesus' ancestry through Solomon, the son of David. And he puts the order this way. Eleazar, Mathan, Jacob, Joseph, Jesus. But Luke traces Jesus' ancestry through Nathan, the son of David. And then he orders it this way. Levi, Mathan, Hilai, Joseph, Jesus. So who was the father of Joseph? Is it Hilai or is it Jacob? Do you see the difference between the two? Is the Bible mistaken? Well, no. There are two possible explanations here. Perhaps Luke gives us Mary's genealogy and then substitutes Joseph's name since he was the head of the family. That's certainly a possibility. More likely, and you can ask me about this later because it's a bit complicated, we have an example where the royal line was transferred to Joseph because Jacob's line didn't have any sons. So Heli was the physical father of Joseph, but the royal line of the throne stemmed from Jacob. But since Jacob didn't have any sons, the royal line passed to Joseph. You have to do that all the time. Right, read about the history of the kings of England when they don't have any children. And then furthermore, we read and learn that Jeconiah's evil was so great that his line was cursed. You read about that in Jeremiah 22. So while a natural biological son could not therefore inherit the throne, the legal claim could still come through Jeconiah's line. So Luke traces Joseph's actual physical descent, moving from David to Nathan, while Matthew provides the line of kingly succession, moving from David to Solomon. And both lines converge at Joseph. Joseph is the legal son of Jacob, but the physical son of Heli, hence the reason for two lines of ancestry. Okay, why does all of this matter? Why should we care? As I said earlier, our faith depends on history, not fundamentally our feelings. Our faith isn't just a philosophy. Jesus was truly born as the son of Mary. He really died, and he was really raised from the dead, and he was really royally descended from David. Edith Schaefer, the wife of Francis Schaefer, was asked once, "Why should I become a Christian?" And she replied, "Because it's true. Because Christianity is the truth." Third observation. This family history is supernatural history. Isn't it interesting that this genealogy begins with a supernatural birth, and it ends with a supernatural birth? It begins with the birth of Abraham's son, Isaac. Supernatural. Not exactly like the virgin birth of Christ, because Abraham and Sarah came together, and yet they were beyond the age of childbearing. Supernaturally, Isaac has been brought into the world. And then Christ is brought into the world supernaturally, in a way that transcends even Isaac. And certainly this genealogy teaches that Jesus is truly human. He comes from a family of humans. That's unmistakably clear. But this genealogy also hints at what the end of the chapter, the very next passage, will make very clear. Jesus is truly God. He was born of a virgin. He was supernaturally conceived by the Holy Spirit. And that supernatural conception of Christ, that virgin birth of Christ, is meant to point to his divine origins and character. We see this stressed even in verse 16. Did you notice the change in verse 16 in form from the rest of the passage? Right, throughout the whole passage, the phrase had been Abraham fathered Isaac, Isaac fathered Jacob, and so on. Here, however, we're told explicitly in verse 16 that Jacob was the father of Joseph, and doesn't say Joseph fathered Christ. No, it says Joseph, the husband of Mary, who gave birth to Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Do you see how Matthew carefully states that? Right? Joseph is not his physical father. He is the father in a legal sense, in a relational sense, in a covenantal sense, but he is not the physical, biological father. Matthew is reminding us of that here, showing us that Jesus is divine. And he's going to expand on that in the next passage. And so all of these patterns are here to remind us of what? Jesus is the true king. He's the one hoped for by the people of God. And therefore, you and I would do well to let Jesus run our lives, because he's the rightful king that fulfills God's gracious promises. Second, I want us to consider the purpose of Jesus' genealogy. The primary purpose of Matthew's genealogy is to show us that Jesus is from the royal line of King David, and therefore, he has a legal claim to the throne over God's people. Notice in verse 1 that Matthew refers to Jesus Christ. Again in verse 16, he says, Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Right? Christ is the Greek equivalent of that Hebrew word for Messiah, meaning anointed one. It's a royal title. It's not Jesus' last name. Okay, Jesus wasn't born to Joseph and Mary Christ. He didn't become part of the Christ family. It's a title, not a name. And so Matthew begins and he ends his genealogy by stating clearly that Jesus has a legal right to the throne of Israel. But what kind of king will Jesus be? With all the messianic expectations that were swirling about in his day, what would he come to do? Let's consider three themes of his kingship from the three sections of his royal family. Just looking at that first unit, verses 2 through 6, Matthew starts with the fact that Jesus is a king who, according to the promises, has come to rescue all peoples everywhere. The first movement of his record of his origin says, here's one who's come to rescue. Now, how do I get rescue from Abraham? Well, if you're not familiar with the scriptures, Abraham doesn't emerge until the 12th chapter of Genesis. Before that, you had five genealogies on Adam's race. And the problem is, everybody keeps dying because of sin. Adam brings ruin. But with Abraham comes a promise of rescue. So that in chapter 12 of Genesis, the Bible articulates that through one man, Abraham, is going to come one in his line who would rescue. Or in the language of the text, he would rescue all the families of the earth. Now think about that. In the Bible story, for 11 chapters, through one man, ruin comes to everybody. But now, through one man, Abraham, rescue will one day be available to all. Right? The Bible is a rescue story. So we see in verse 1 and in verse 17, Jesus is the son of Abraham. Now, why is Abraham emphasized? Because he's the father of the Jewish people. He's the beginning of the Jewish nation. What's the most important fact to know about Abraham? Not that he was right with God by faith, although that's important. And not that he sacrificed Isaac, although that's a wonderful example of his faith. But the most important fact to know about Abraham is that God made a covenant with him. And in that covenant, he received a promise from the Lord, a promise that's repeated many times throughout the Old Testament. Let's just read the first time he received the promise. This is Genesis 12, 1-3. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your land, your relatives, and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse anyone who treats you with contempt. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So God promised to make Abraham great, that he would have children, that he would have a land. But the most important promise is that he would bless all nations through Abraham's offspring. And this is repeated over and over again in the Old Testament, that there would be a worldwide blessing. And Matthew is saying in this genealogy, starting in the very first verse, that promise has now come to fulfillment in Jesus Christ. This genealogy is Jewish, but the reference to Abraham shows all nations are going to be included in this promise. We read in Revelation 5, 9-10, that Jesus purchased through his blood some from every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. Our Messiah is the Messiah for the whole world. He's the one through whom all the nations are blessed. It is through him alone that all the nations can be blessed. He's not just the Jewish Messiah. Now, he's the Messiah for the Uzbeks. He's the Messiah for the Turks. He's the Messiah for the Chinese. He's the Messiah for the Brazilians. He's the Messiah for all people everywhere. Are Christians cultural imperialists because we impose our religion on others? No. We're not cultural imperialists, right? We don't force other people to become Christians. Some have wrongly done that in history, in their sin. That's not what the New Testament teaches. We don't force anyone. We don't coerce anyone to become a believer. But we persuade people, right? That's a big difference. What a dramatic difference between forcing and persuading. Why do we try to persuade? Because Jesus is the Messiah for all peoples. Acts 4:12 says, "There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to people, to men, all people, by which we must be saved." Right? There's only one way. John 14:6, Jesus told Thomas, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one from any tribe comes to the Father except through me." And so we're being faithful to Jesus. We're not being proud and saying there's only one way. We're actually being humble. We're trusting Jesus in his own words. Let's remember, Christianity isn't a Western religion. It was birthed in the Mideast, but it's not even a Mideast religion. It's a religion for all peoples in all places. And so we're eager to tell everyone from every tribe, every language, every people, every nation, that the blessing of Abraham, The salvation that they receive from God from their sins comes only through Jesus the Messiah. But then he moves on. Jesus is not merely a king who would come to our rescue, verses 2 through 6, but he's a king who will rule us eternally. That's the movement of verses 7 through 11. You can see how it opens. David fathered Solomon. And then you have a listing of names who ascended to the throne of Israel. Matthew moves you from the promise of rescue to the promise of rule. And that's perhaps emphasized more than anything else in this genealogy. The Old Testament emphasizes that the blessing promised to Abraham would then now come through a son of David, through David's line. You see a narrowing there. A covenant was made to David in 2 Samuel 7. And in that covenant, God promised to bless David's line forever with the kingship, with the kingdom. God promised David, one from his own line, would rule forever over an everlasting kingdom. Right? It would never end. One of his sons would rule, would sit on the throne forever. And while Israel's kingdom crumbled, the prophets kept that promise alive. They kept holding that forth to the people. And then after centuries of waiting, Matthew announces that this son of David has finally arrived. He traces Jesus' lineage right through David, the king, and up to Joseph, another son of David, who then brings Jesus into his royal line. And as a consequence of his life, his death, and his resurrection, Jesus now has the right to reign forever as king. And so immediately when a Jew reads this genealogy, when he reads the emphasis not only on Abraham, but on David, he would see that Jesus is the fulfillment of that promise given to David. I want to select out just three passages from the Old Testament about this promise. Isaiah 9, 6 through 7, we read there, "For a child will be born for us, a son will be given to us, and the government will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. The dominion will be vast, and its prosperity will never end. He will reign on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish and sustain it with justice and righteousness from now on and forever." So the one we worship is the ruler of all. The government is upon his shoulders. The Davidic rule belongs to him, to Jesus Christ. He sits now at the right hand of God the Father. Is Jesus ruling now? Yes, he's ruling now. We don't have the complete fullness of his rule, but Jesus reigns now as the Messiah and as the Son of David. And so the most important thing for your life is that you obey and follow him. He's a wonderful counselor, so you can trust him with your life. You can trust him with major decisions you have to make since he is your counselor. You can trust him because he's a mighty God. He has the strength to help you. You may be going through some difficulty, some hardship, some trial. Remember, Jesus is a mighty God. He can strengthen you. He can fortify you. He can carry you through any hard time you may face. He will never leave you or forsake you. He's an eternal Father. If you feel forsaken by friends, forsaken by family, if you feel lonely, maybe you've lost a spouse, and you feel lonely, especially at night. Well, Jesus is an eternal Father who loves us, who sustains us in our loneliness. When we feel abandoned or forsaken, feel there's no one there for us, Jesus is an eternal Father who loves us, who sustains us in our loneliness. He's an eternal Father who cares for us, is faithful. And then he's a Prince of Peace. Are you disturbed in your heart or in your spirit? Are you worried about something? Are you anxious? Are you upset? He's the Prince of Peace to comfort you and to give you a peace that overcomes the world. This is the kind of king that he is. We also read about Jesus as the Messiah in Jeremiah 23, 5 through 6. "Look, the days are coming," this is the Lord's declaration, "when I will raise up a righteous branch for David. He will reign wisely as king and administer justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell securely. This is the name he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. That prophecy, too, is fulfilled in Jesus. He's that new David that God raised up. We have a Messiah who is our righteousness. We look at ourselves, we see our unrighteousness, don't we? Our uncleanness. Before God, we're filthy. Before God, we're sinners. We can't stand before him on our own. But when we look to Jesus and when we receive him, we see that Jesus is our righteousness. And by faith in him, we can stand before God. We can be clean before God because of what Jesus has done in dying for our sins and being raised from the dead. We can stand before him pure. We can stand before him with confidence. We can stand before him with joy. We're unworthy, but we can come to Jesus and say, you are my Savior. You're the one who now qualifies me to be right before God. And just another comment there. Don't you long for a world where there's justice and peace? How much of the world is driven by corruption? The governments of the world. How much strife and envy and quarreling there is among people. How much injustice there is. How much hatred. We long for a world in which there's no more of that. But justice reigns. There's peace once again. That's coming through Jesus. We read about it in Isaiah 11. We can experience a foretaste of that even now when we trust in Jesus. You know, our community here, we're not a perfect community, but we can experience significantly the justice and the peace and the love that comes through Jesus. In any case, a new world is coming. And that is where we put our hope. And it's coming through Christ. One more Old Testament text, Ezekiel 34, 23 to 24. That prophet writes, I will establish over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will shepherd them. He will tend them himself and will be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. This is obviously not like that last passage, not speaking of a literal David, right? David's dead and gone. This is a prophecy about the David to come. And we're told here, he'll be our shepherd. He'll be our king. He'll rule over us, but he will also feed us and guide us and strengthen us. We're not defenseless before our enemies since we have a Davidic shepherd in Jesus. So Matthew's argument is God sent the fulfillment of two massive promises in one person. The promise that went out to Abraham of familial rescue across the board, and the promise that went out to David of a ruler who would be forever established in ways that he could run your life well. It's all there in the genealogy. Matthew claims he is a king, he's connected to God's previous Old Testament belief of promise, and he's connected to God's previous promise to David that he's laid out. He's a rescuer, and he's a ruler. But then notice this strange movement in the third part. Verses 11 and 12 trace the genealogy until you get to the time of the deportation to Babylon, the exile. And what is going on here? Evidently, according to Matthew, he wants us to be introduced to his work, his book, by knowing that Jesus not only came to our rescue, Jesus is not only a king who will rule us well forever, but Jesus is the one who will redeem you from your own exile. Now, how do I get there? This third movement, this final branch that emerges from this tree, speaks of a time of exile to Babylon. And I don't assume that you would have full understanding of what this is referencing to, but when you read the Old Testament, you find that while David was a king, the people were rebellious. David himself ruled well, but not well enough. And so the people began to do whatever they wanted under God's king. And then, at times, the king himself did whatever he wanted. We see that even here in this genealogy. And therefore, he wasn't the one that you ought to follow forever. And so there's this exile. This is what God did. He actually took his own people, moved them out of the land of promise, and he sent them into exile in Babylon. The northern tribes had already been taken to Assyria in 722 BC, and now the southern kingdom of Judah was deported in 586 BC, all because of their sins. The Babylonian Empire came in, they hauled off the last of Israel's tribes, and it looked like all those great promises that had come down to God's people through Abraham and David, it almost looked like they were dwindling away forever. It almost looked like the light of promise was going to flicker out and never be fulfilled. Israel fades from the scene. There are a few people, a remnant, who still hang on. They still believe that God might get something done. Right? Do you ever feel like that? God makes a promise, but we go wayward anyway. And as the list is unfolding, it's almost heightening the sense of urgency, the desperation. By the time you get to that third leg, is it really possible that anything is now going to get done? God had ruled, he had rescued, but Israel's rebellion becomes a snare. Well, let me put it to you in the words of one hymn. We mourn in lonely exile here. Why does Matthew include the exile? Because the Israel of Jesus' day was still in exile. They were back in the land, yes, but they had no political power. They were under the thumb of Rome. Every good Jew would believe, we're under the thumb of Rome. The thumb of Rome. That's not what God promised. We'll only be free if we're freed from our sin. And that's why the Pharisees were there. If you know Jewish history, that's why the Essenes went out in the wilderness to get away from the unclean people and create a society that was righteous, so that they believed God's promises would be fulfilled that way. But God's people truly believed they were still in exile. But the focus here is not on that political exile, is it? They're exiled from God himself. It's a sense in which they've returned physically from the exile, but they haven't yet been brought into God's kingdom. They're still longing for a spiritual return. And Jesus is coming now to fulfill that, to bring his people back. And he teaches us that those who confess Jesus as their Messiah are forgiven of their sins. They enjoy God's peace and they're brought home to God. And before we know God, scriptures teach, we're all in exile from him. We're all alienated from him. Paul says in Ephesians 2, we're foreigners to the covenants of promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is a great hope that we have. Our Messiah is the one who has redeemed us from our exile. He's removed that. We're right with him through faith in Christ. Jesus came, as Matthew 1:21 says, to save us from our sins. And he'll do that through his death on the cross and his resurrection. And when we confess our sins, we come to our true home. We find the true meaning of our lives when we embrace Jesus as our Messiah, as our Lord and our Savior. Well, thirdly, I want us to consider now the people in the genealogy. He came from a true family. He came from a royal family. But thirdly, we need to see that Jesus came from a broken family. Jesus' family history isn't what most people would expect a king to come from. His family line was far from squeaky clean. When you start to scratch the surface of the nativity scene, you'll find that Jesus came from a broken, dysfunctional, immoral, sinful family. Let's look at some of these people, starting with Abraham. Abraham was a liar and a coward. He told his wife, Sarah, to lie and say that she was his sister so that his life would be spared in Egypt. And then he did it again when he told a man named Abimelech that she was his sister. Isaac, like his father, was also a liar and a coward. He also told Abimelech that his wife, Rebekah, was his sister so that his life would be spared. Jacob, like his father and grandfather, was also a liar and a schemer. Jacob literally means he cheats. He hustled his brother Esau for his birthright. He plotted with his mother Rebekah to trick Jacob into blessing him instead of Esau. Two times he straight up lied to his dad and told him that he was Esau. Judah was the one who convinced his brothers to sell their youngest brother Joseph into slavery. Tamar was guilty of prostitution and incest. She married Judah's firstborn son, but when her husband died, she dressed up like a prostitute and sold herself to her father-in-law, Judah. And he even says she's more righteous than I am. Perez and Zerah were the products of that relationship. Rahab was a Canaanite prostitute. She helped the Israelite spies when they came to Jericho, and her life was spared, and she mercifully became part of the people of God. But before God saved her, she was selling her body for sex. Also in verse 5, you see Ruth. She was a godly lady, but she was an outcast because she was a Moabite. The Moabite people were the result of Lot's incestuous relationship with his daughters, and they were denied access to the people of God for 10 generations. Then in verse 6, you see David, who fathered Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Isn't that a sordid story? Matthew makes it clear that David's son, Solomon, was the result of an adulterous relationship. Solomon came from another man's wife. Not named here, but we know it's Bathsheba, whom David stole, used, and then had her husband killed in an effort to cover his tracks. Solomon also indulged in sexual sin, marrying and sleeping with hundreds of foreign women and concubines. His house was dysfunctional. His sons ended up splitting the kingdom of Israel. Rehoboam, one of Solomon's sons, was an arrogant young man who listened to the advice of his ungodly friends instead of the older, wiser men that had served with his father. Uzziah allowed false worship to continue in Judah, and so the Lord made him a leper and therefore unclean. Ahaz was engaged in all-out pagan worship, burning one of his own sons as an offering to the pagan gods. Manasseh rebuilt all the altars to false gods that his father Hezekiah had torn down. He even built altars to the pagan gods in the courts of the temple in Jerusalem. Yes, there's the occasional Jehoshaphat and Hezekiah and Josiah who did what was right. But for the most part, this family tree is full of sinners and scoundrels. Jesus' family tree was not something to brag about. But it does have something to teach us, doesn't it? I want to notice three things, three lessons as we conclude. First, it teaches us that women are welcomed into God's family. Contrary to the Jewish custom, the women are featured prominently in this genealogy. You know, ordinarily, ancient genealogies trace the lineage through the men. And so the inclusion of five women is unusual. You got Tamar, Rahab, and Ruth, who were Gentiles, non-Jews. And then you have Tamar, Rahab, and maybe Bathsheba, involved in some scandals, as we've seen. And then you have Mary, an unknown virgin. Why are these women here? I think we see here that God's plan of salvation has always included women. In fact, the promise from the very beginning that there was to be a seed of a woman who would come. Some say the Bible teaches that men are more important than women, that women don't matter. Some Christians, even in history, have wrongly denigrated women, haven't they? But I would say if you look at the whole of human history, women have flourished where the Christian faith has flourished. Women have advanced where biblical truth is believed and proclaimed and lived. And as our society turns from the Christian faith, I think we see more and more that women are just turned into objects. You hear stories in the media about campus rape, trying to control it. Now, that problem only gets worse as we turn in our society away from Christianity. It's not going to get any better. Our society is struggling with objectifying women more than ever before. And that's not an accident where many reject the Christian faith. But the Bible doesn't see women as objects, but as equally made in the image of God. It's not that men or women are more important than the other, right? Everyone is made in the image of God, and everyone is valuable before God. Second, we also see that outsiders are welcomed. It should be pointed out, again, that the first three of these women were Gentiles. And even in Bathsheba's case, if you look there at the genealogy in verse 6, she's not mentioned by name. Her husband is mentioned by name, Uriah, and Uriah was a Hittite. He was a Gentile. And so I think we see here that these women are named to remind us again that God's salvation is for all people, everywhere. It's not just limited to the Jews. God's salvation comes to all the nations. And then thirdly, most remarkably, most strikingly, we've seen that these men and women were sinners. They were notoriously involved in scandalous sins. And yet some of them were saved. We're reminded that God's grace reaches down and saves sinners. No matter how low one goes, no matter how far one has fallen, God's grace reaches down and saves the most unlikely. So no one ought to think in here, and that includes children, no one ought to think in here that you are too much of a sinner to be saved by the grace of God. Nor ought anyone to think in here that it is those who are good and respectable who are Christians. Right, don't be fooled if you look around this room and think, the people in here are respectable people. The people in here are good people. The people in here are moral people. None of us in here is really a respectable person in and of ourselves, although we like to think of ourselves more highly than we ought. No, we all desperately are in need of a Savior. We're not better than these women or these men. None of us is better than these. We all stand desperately in need of God's grace. And this is the good news of the gospel, that God saves sinners through Jesus Christ. We're not saved on the basis of what we've done or what we've accomplished. We're saved by the wonderful and remarkable grace of God to sinners. Praise God for his salvation. What I want to say by way of bringing this to conclusion for your heart and mind today. We began by wondering, what's up with Matthew beginning with a genealogy? But now that we've seen his purpose, the right question we need to ask ourselves is, what's up with my genealogy? I'll put it to you this way this morning. Jesus stands ready to replant you into his family line. Think about that. Your family line might be a mess, but you can be included in his line. Not everyone in Jesus' genealogy was saved by Jesus. John tells us he came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be called children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of natural descent, not of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. So how do you find your way into his line? Repent of your sins. Believe that his death and resurrection is sufficient for your forgiveness. And then by faith, receive him and begin to follow him. And if that happens, roots can come out of dry ground, and there might be someone sitting in this auditorium some 30, 40, 50, 80 years from now that comes from your line because you decided to place yourself in Jesus' line. And so I want nothing less to persuade you that Jesus is worth your following. Not on my emotion, not on my preacherly passion, but on the fact that he's a fulfillment of God's gracious promises, and in him you can rest. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that this genealogy, the story of Jesus' family, is the most important genealogy in the world. And there's nothing more important than belonging to this family. And Lord, we praise you for your grace that through Jesus we can be members of this family, that we can be grafted in by faith, that our exile has ended, and that we are right with you once again. Lord, I pray that each one of us in here would truly belong to you, and that our hearts would be full of joy and grace if we do, and that we would long to see this word go to the ends of the earth. I pray this in Jesus, our wonderful Messiah's name. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, our final song this morning is Come, Thou Long-Expected Jesus, which you can find as an insert in your bulletin. Let's stand and sing this hymn together.
Come, thou long-expected.
Amen. What a wonderful hope we have in our King Jesus. If you have any questions about how you can become part of his family today, please speak with us before you leave. Brothers and sisters, receive now this good word from God's word. Peace to the brothers and sisters. Isn't it great to be called that? And love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all who have undying love for our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Go in that grace.